Can you hear me clearly, Sir Toffee?
Yes.
Okay, thank you.
Are you ready?
Yeah, I'm ready. And I am also excited to be speaking. Thank you.
For a minute. This connection is so bad.
Yeah, wait a minute because the moderator is still preparing his device.
No problem. How are you, Sir Taufik?
Fine, amazing. Nice to meet you again.
Nice to see you again, virtually.
I think Mr. Ari joined this lecture. Hello, Mr. Ari. Where are you? This one? Oh,
yeah. I am. Nice to meet you again, Prof. Daeng.
Oh, you're here, Ari. Okay, good to see you. Okay. Topic, our students are all elementary education students.
Yes, the participants from elementary school teacher education students.
Education, okay. You just give me signal, Sir Taufik, if we can already start. Thank you.
Yes, the moderator just ready right now, Mr. Aldi.
Hello, Prof. Daeng.
Interconnect, siya.
Okay.
Okay.
Mr. Aldo.
Pak Taufik, bisa saya menyapa Pak Krisanto, Prof. Krisanto Daeng dulu? Good morning, Prof. Good morning, Prof. Daeng. Nice to meet you.
I'm happy to see all of you as well. Morning.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. for sharing in this forum.
Yeah, it's always my pleasure. It's always my pleasure, ma'am.
Okay. Hopefully, this forum will be beneficial for everyone in here or in Indonesia, Mr. Okay. Thank you very much.
Okay. So shall I now start with my presentation?
Yes.
Okay. Thank you, everyone. And of course, I would like to thank first your university, Universitas Muhammadiyah Surakarta, and the department for inviting me again for a lecture. A topic that is very much close to my heart, because I myself is an elementary education graduate and practitioner majoring in English. So I am happy to be speaking in front of future elementary teachers, okay, who will be teaching English to Indonesian students. Before I came up with my presentation this morning, I hope I am clear on your end. Can you hear me clearly? Thank you. Okay. Ari, can you hear me?
Yes.
Yes, I can. Okay. Yes.
Right. Thank you. Thank you. I also did my research about Indonesia speaking English as a language, and I found out that it's more than 30% of Indonesians speak English very well. So I think that is already a good start, no? Because you know, you have been exposed into speaking the English language. I'm just giving you an idea, because in the Philippines, of course, English is our second language. So that's why, if not all, most of the Filipinos really speak English very well. So my topic this morning is about engaging young minds, innovative approaches to teaching English. Okay, I will only be discussing with you few strategies on how to teach English to our students now. Right, because let us remember that for a country like Indonesia or the Philippines, teaching English really is something that is a challenge. Do you agree? I mean, this requires a multifaceted approach in order for us to cater to the developmental stage of our learners, of our students, so that we would also know their learning styles and their individual needs as well. Let us be reminded that teaching English as a language is more than just about memorizing words in order for you to enrich your vocabulary, right? It's not only about the rules in grammar that we need to be attentive so that we're able to master the grammar rules and speak good English. Right? But teaching English is nurturing the natural curiosity of our young learners in order to explore the world through words. Okay, so my presentation this morning will delve into effective strategies that can make learning English a delightful one, something that the students will find joy while they are learning English, and an enriching experience for our young children. Okay. Now, let me just present to you the developmental stages of language acquisition. So you will understand better about language acquisition in your further studies. But let me just show you some, okay? I hope you can read it. So in the pre-language stage, that is from 0 to 1 year old. So the infants, the babies, begin to develop their understanding of the language by listening to the sounds. So that's why we give the sounds of the letters of our alphabet, okay? And recognizing familiar voices. So the voices of the people around the infant or around the baby are also relevant for a baby to utter a word. So if you constantly talk to babies, you get my point? When you constantly talk to babies, then the babies or the infants would start bubbling for words. Do you agree? And they would also try to imitate the sounds. No? So we are laying down the foundation for the development of language of our children. Are you with me? Can you hear me clearly? Hopefully. Okay, thank you. And the second stage is the early language stage. So the babies, when they are 1 to 2 years old. So infants from 1 to 2 years old or the children begin to acquire a few basic words or phrases. So they would start to acquire phrases or words like mama, papa, right? Dad, or whatever language that the people in the household are using. They can understand simple instructions and are able to communicate their basic needs through gestures and words. And this stage is marked by rapid vocabulary expansion. So in the development of the language, it is also necessary that we use our gestures. Our gestures, hand gestures, facial expressions, so the children will learn from us. The third stage is the later language stage, 2 to 5 years old. We're already in the third stage, as you can see in my presentation. So children start to develop more complex language skills, including sentence construction. So they would start creating sentences now, right? They understand the grammar rules, okay? And at the same time, they try to understand more complex concepts. So they're able to engage in conversations. And the children from 2 to 5 years old would also be very courageous in asking questions. They would clarify their sentences. They would ask questions. And the last stage, which is 4 to 7 years old, is what we call as the emergent literacy. What do you mean by emergent literacy? This stage involves the transition from spoken language to written language. So the skill now of the children is from speaking English language and translating it now to writing English language. So there are already two skills in the emergent literacy. Do you hear me? From speaking, they will now also gain the skill in writing. So the children begin to recognize letters and sounds and start to decode simple words. They also begin to understand the concept of print and how it relates to the spoken language. Okay, I hope you heard me clearly as I proceed now to my next slide. So I would like to start presenting the 5 principles in teaching English to young children. Okay. So the first one, if you can see from my presentation, let me just do the slide share. Okay. The first one is rich language. What do I mean by rich language? Can you hear me, Ari? Okay.
Yes, I can, Prof.
Thank you. What do you mean by rich language? So if we are teaching English to young children, it is expected that children also are exposed to English language, right? They are taught how to speak English, so people around him should also be speaking English. He should be exposed into English, English series or songs that are English. Okay, so that the children will have the capacity to learn English language. I hope you got my point. So if your intention is to teach English and you want your children to learn English in the classroom, you should be speaking English all the time. That is rich language. Because one cannot learn English fast, cannot understand English very well, if the environment, if people around, if the classroom is not even supportive about the English language. So that is the first principle, no? Rich language. The second principle would be engaged learning. As you can see in my presentation, okay? So you have to make the students be engaged into activities that would develop their thinking skills in English, their speaking skills, their written skills, the writing skills. Okay, you provide them all activities so that they can practice their English. They can speak in English. So give them activities that they can role play, right? They can think, they can collaborate with their classmates, they can plan on what they are going to do, and they can deliver using the English language. So for me, that is very much important, no? Engaged learning. Okay, so when you say engaged learning, that should be student-centered. You get that? That should be student-centered. The third principle is this one, fluency developments. Okay, what do you mean by fluency developments? We all know very well that one can only be fluent if one is given the opportunity to be exposed into the English language. And when we want to develop fluency of our students when it comes to English language, it is necessary that teachers in the classroom teaching English are consistent with the use of the English language. Do you hear me? So that's the third principle, fluency developments. Number four, meaningful practice. Okay, what do you mean by meaningful practice? It's not enough that we teach our students how to sound the letters of the alphabet, or that we teach our students how to say the sentences. Okay, it should be meaningful. You provide them with relevant activities where they could practice their English. Okay, because when you provide your students with relevant activities, then obviously little by little you realize that your students become fluent with the use of the English language. Okay, so that is the fourth principle. And of course, the last one would be the culture. The culture is a foundation of one's learning of the English language. So you let that be a culture, the culture of being patient in teaching our students English, because again, English is not our mother tongue. Do you agree? We have our own native language. Right. But why are we teaching our kids, our students English? It is because we know that the globe communicates in English. Do you agree? Okay. I remember the time when we had our collaboration, Sir Tofik and Ari, when you arrived in the Philippines and we had that student exchange and activities. Okay, we had our meetings, we have our engagements in our adapted community, in our students, and everything in there would have been very difficult if Ari could not speak English, if Tofik, Sir Tofik could not speak in English, and the rest of the members of the team. Am I correct, Ari? Right? But because you're able to communicate English, that's already part of our culture. We're able to deal with each other. We're able to interact with one another. So let that be our culture, part of our culture. Because again, we cannot do away from the fact that after all, the globe speaks in English. Okay? And we don't want to be left behind. Right? Because of a globalized world, huh? Everybody is speaking English for understanding, for communication. Okay. Now, these are the interactive strategies or approaches that we can use, okay, when we are teaching our children English. Number one, for me, this is very much effective. Number one is storytelling and read alouds. Hello,
Prof. Sorry. I'm sorry. The PowerPoint has not moved yet, Mr.
This one, can you see it?
Yeah.
Yes. Just hold on. Thank you. I'll go to transitions or. Is it animation? I'm sorry, I don't know. Slideshow. Okay. This one. Let me just check. This time around, is it moving?
Yes, bro.
This one, is it moving now?
Yes, Mr.
Thank you.
Yes.
Okay. So the first strategy that is, for me, very much effective, especially for young children, is storytelling and reading aloud. I know you're familiar with what storytelling is. So when you do storytelling, you have to read it aloud to your children. Okay, when I was a classroom teacher teaching grade one and grade two students, the primary students, I would really engage my students. Okay, I would gather them, I would be at the center, and I would tell them a story during English time. And I believe that my children then really enjoyed storytelling. Okay, so reading aloud, engaging stories with rich vocabulary and vivid descriptions can spark children's imagination, okay? That will trigger their imagination and help them develop their listening comprehension skills. Because when you do your storytelling and you're reading aloud, for you to check whether your students are listening to you, from time to time, in the middle of you doing the storytelling or at the end of the storytelling, you give them guide questions for them to answer. You get my point? So, for example, if you are telling a story and then in the middle of the story, you ask a question. So who is that character who came from a poor family? And the children would answer, it is Diana. Very good. So Diana came from a poor family. So let's continue with the story, right? Okay, I know you're familiar with storytelling, but this is just a reminder, no? That this is still a very effective strategy for our students to be engaged in English. Number two, interactive games and activities. All right? I know you have your culture and how you are going to make games and activities in our motivational part of our lesson, right? In the motivation part, or perhaps in the development of our lesson, because take note that we should always make our classroom fun. That learning English is fun. Let us help eliminate the concept of our students that English is a difficult language to learn. Well, in fact, it is not. Do you agree? So let's make our English classroom an interactive one by using games, by providing them activities. So the games that you use in your the motivation part of your lesson, in the assessment of the lesson, can really make learning fun. And obviously, that could encourage participation. Okay? I know that making our students cooperate in the discussion is also a challenge, right? Especially when the students think, when our children think that English is boring, that English is difficult. Did you get my point? But when you inject some interactive games and activities in there, they will just participate in the discussion. Okay? So the interactive activities can also be used to reinforce vocabulary and grammar concepts. Number three, okay, hands-on activities. What do you mean by hands-on activities? Okay, it means that you are providing them activities that the children themselves are the ones in charge in the activity. They plan. They construct their lines, they construct their scripts, they deliver, they role play, and later on, they evaluate their performance. Okay, that's hands-on activity. No? So engaging children in hands-on activities like crafts or art projects or role playing, I know you're familiar with this one, okay? That can help them connect the language with real-world experience because they will be practicing using the English language, right? When you ask the students to be in group dynamics, you are giving them an activity in a group, then the students in group will have to brainstorm. That is already a meaningful practice. And when they brainstorm, when they plan, you are not just making them connect with their classmates. You are not just developing their social skills as they interact with their classmates, but you are at the same time creating or developing their creative and critical thinking skills. So see, when we only provide our students with engaging and hands-on activities, there are a lot of skills that are also being developed in them. Do you hear me? Did you get that? Okay, hands-on activities, right? And the last one would be the use of songs and rhymes. Okay, because children love to sing. Is it a yes? Do you agree that little children love to sing? Okay, they love to sing. So that's why we strategize even in the development of our lesson, we strategize in giving them activities, making it a song, right? Providing them rhymes because they love that one, okay? I could even recall when I was teaching my students, my little children, parts of the body. Okay, so I know you're familiar with the song about my toes, my knees, my shoulder, my head, right? So you're making it a song. So when it is a song now, when you're teaching about parts of the body, you don't only mention my toes, my knees, And then after that one, you can change the types, the parts of the body. My hips, my tummy, my neck, and my nose. Okay? So songs and rhymes can help children learn new words and develop their phonological awareness. That's also important, no? You make them say the words, you let them sing. So little by little, they master the sounds of the letters of the alphabet. They master how to utter the words. Okay? So songs and rhymes are also a great way to make learning fun. Do you understand? Do you hear me? I hope you understand that one. And you got that one. That it is important, no? That we really help our students in making them speak English language or use English language by utilizing interactive strategies. I know there are a lot of strategies out there, okay? But I just highlighted some because these are for little children, okay? Are you familiar with the think, pair, and share activity strategy? Are you familiar with that one? Think, pair, and share. Okay, I'm writing. That is also another activity. That is dyadic activity. Okay, you ask your students in pair. Okay, you give them a question. They have to think. And then after thinking about the question, they are going to share their answers with their seatmate or with their classmate. That is another strategy, okay? Think, pair, and share. A lot of strategies, actually. Okay, now let me continue with my presentation. Now, because we are teaching 21st century learners, and we cannot deny the fact that our classrooms really integrate multimedia and technology. Do you agree? Do we use technology in our classroom? Yeah?
Yes, bro.
Yes. Do we have television in our classroom? Do we have the Wi-Fi connection? Do we have access to technological resources? Yes. Okay. And number one, the educational applications. They are just in the internet. I know you're familiar with Kahoot. That is an educational app. Okay? And a lot of apps that are available even for free. Okay? There's even a way on how we can make our PowerPoint presentation interactive. Okay? There is this class point that is how to make your PowerPoint interactive. So the interactive applications can provide fun and engaging way for children to practice their English skills. They can play games, they can listen to stories, and they learn new vocabulary words. Okay? Even there's YouTube for kids. So one interesting about my children, I have two children, okay? Two daughters. One is already 9 years old and the other is 7 years old. You know what? Before my children reached 5 years old, they already knew how to read. So when they were 5 years old, they were reading. So when I sent them to school for first grade, the teachers no longer had the problem on how to make my daughters read, because they already know how to read. And of course, because I am an English teacher, I engage them with exercises. Later, I'll show you one of my video clips with my daughters when I was teaching them how to read. But the very important thing that helped them read, learn English is through the use of educational apps. Okay? So I would expose them to YouTube for kids, in which there are stories, right? There are a lot of series that they could listen to. Okay, so that's why it's not that I am bragging. That's why my kids are very good speakers of the English language. Okay, because I believe in the educational apps. Second, animated videos. Our animated videos are just accessible. Do you agree? Okay, there are a lot of animated videos. No? They can be a great tool for introducing new concepts and vocabulary words, right? They can also help children learn about different cultures and perspective. So even in our classroom, let us bring those animated videos to our classroom and let the students enjoy them. Did you get my point? Let us take advantage of technology, the resources, the tools are just available. They are accessible. Okay? And since almost all households already have connection, we have gadgets, we have laptop, so take advantage of those available resources. Interactive whiteboards. Okay, the interactive whiteboards can create a dynamic and engaging learning environment. They allow teachers to present information in a visually stimulating way to interact with students in real time. Even if we hold classes virtually, because of interactive whiteboards, our students can see us writing, solving, correct? And interactive whiteboards are embedded in Canvas. We have the big blue button. We have the Google, right? We can use interactive whiteboards now, okay? And the fourth one that we can incorporate in a classroom that is lean towards multimedia and technology is the use of online games. Online games that are related to English. I hope you don't get me wrong, no? Online games can provide a fun and engaging way to children to practice their English skills. They can play games, listen to stories, and learn new vocabulary words. Just like my daughters, you know, what they're playing online is crossword puzzle. So I was surprised a few months ago when my first grader and my third grader played crossword puzzle and they enjoyed it. The basic crossword puzzle online, okay, in which the words are already written and they will just have to look for the words inside the puzzle, okay? That is helpful because that would add up to their vocabulary and at the same time, that helps their critical thinking skills. Do you hear me? You understand? Thank you, Ari.
Yes, I got it.
All right. Now, for me, it is also important that we take note of this. An English classroom or a classroom that teaches English should be a positive learning environment. Okay? So everyone in school whose intent is to make our children speak English, write English, learn English, should be supportive in the learning environment. So you create a safe and supportive space. A positive learning environment should be a place where children feel safe, they are respected, and they are encouraged to take risks. This means creating a space where mistakes are seen as opportunities for learning and where the children are praised for their efforts. Let us not forget that it's okay if our children create mistakes in English. Their grammar is not good. It's just okay. You just let them speak. Their grammar in writing is bad. It's just okay. You just ask them to continue writing. Okay? just make sure that you help them correct their bad grammar so that they are aware of what is the correct way of writing it. What is the correct way of saying it in English? Did you get my points? Okay. Do not embarrass children when they learn English, because if you do embarrass them, they will lose their appetite in learning English. They might be scared in speaking English because the teacher is cranky, because the teacher immediately gets mad when I mispronounce words, when I do not say the words correctly all the time, when I commit some grammar errors, the teacher gets mad. If that is the behavior of the teacher, then you are fostering an environment that is threatening to them. Hear, hear? Do you hear me clearly? Right. So let us remember supportive environment, safe environments. Number two, encouraging curiosity and exploration. So a positive learning environment would always trigger the students' curiosity to learn. They have to make them eager to learn, curious to learn. And you know what fuels them to be curious in learning English? What makes them interested in learning English? It's you, the teacher. Okay? When the children don't find learning English interesting, there must be something wrong about you as the English teacher. I so much believe in that. But if you are a friendly teacher, you are an encouraging teacher, you are a patient teacher, you allow students to commit errors, then they will be interested in learning English. Okay? So that's why we always ask students if they have questions. Okay? We encourage them to ask questions. We are not just content of no questions at all at the end of our lesson. Okay? Because when they ask questions, we provide them an opportunity for them to be curious. Okay? So as a teacher as well, let us be mindful of giving them activities or exercises for them to explore the language. Okay? How can they explore the language? Give them hands-on activities. You allow them to role play. Okay? You allow them to experiment. You allow them to discover. Did you get that? So that is important, no? In fostering a positive learning environment. And number three, in order for us to achieve this kind of learning environment, is when you celebrate diversity and inclusion. What does it mean? A positive learning environment should celebrate diversity and inclusivity. This means creating a space where all children feel valued and respected, regardless of their background or abilities. Whether if they're coming from a rich family, from a poor family, diba? Even if they don't belong to the top 10, okay? They feel valued, okay? You love everybody in the classroom. You don't play favoritism. So celebrating diversity and inclusivity can be done by using variety of resources and materials that represent diverse cultures and perspectives. Say, for example, in your classroom, if there are still 10 students or 10 children who have difficulty in mastering the skill, you provide them more activities for them to master the skill. And those who already have mastered, you also provide them activities so that they will not be bored while they are waiting for their classmates to learn to acquire the skill. That is inclusivity. Okay? Though you have your students in one classroom, you treat them as an individual learner, and that each learner has a different need. that you need to fulfill. Hear, hear? Okay? That is what is meant by celebrating diversity and inclusion. Now, let me just share with you some of the effective classroom management strategies. So, if you are an English teacher, you're teaching English to your children, to your students. Well, actually, this management classroom strategies can be applied to all, can be used by all teachers. Number one, it is important that you establish clear expectations and rules. Okay? What are your objectives? So the children need clear guidance and expectations. Explain classroom rules and consequences in positive and age-appropriate way. Make sure that children understand what is expected from them and why. For example, if the intention is at the end of the lesson, you expect that the students construct sentences. Okay? You have to make it clear to them so that at the end of the lesson, the students know that what is expected from them is for them to create sentences. You understand that? Okay? Establish clear expectations and rules. Number two, use positive reinforcement. So the students feel valued and respected if you acknowledge their efforts, right? If you give praises, if you provide positive reinforcements. So praises and positive reinforcement can be powerful tools for motivating children to learn. These encourage and reward good behavior, effort, and progress. Okay? So do not forget when someone says a very good sentence, then you say, wonderful. Okay? That's fantastic. When someone is doing well in the activity, then you let that someone be recognized by the class. Right? That is positive reinforcement. Because when children feel that they are valued because of what they have done, because of their performance, they will have the drive to do more, to cooperate more in your discussion. Okay? You get that? Okay? Number three, provide opportunities for choices. For me, this is important. Okay? We provide activities. Okay, we give them activities that they can have the choice on what to do, diba? Right? Giving children some choices in their learning activities can help them feel more engaged and responsible. Because in the first place, this is my choice. So I have to do this one. I have to give my best because this is my choice. This is really what I want to do. Okay? It can also help them develop their self-confidence and independence, right? Interactive choices, okay? Multifaceted choices, choices that would cater to their intelligences. Diba? Take note, remember about the theory of multiple intelligences. Diba? Our children might be in one classroom, but they have different intelligences. Now, if you provide them choices that will address their intelligences, then that would be much better. And number four, use time management techniques. You establish a consistent daily routine. You know, establishing a routine in an English classroom is very much helpful. You use visual timers to help children understand the structure of the day. For example, before you go to your next lesson, you have to give them review lesson. So you review the lesson from the previous day. Then after the review lesson, you have to give them drills or exercises so that they master the lesson. Okay? So that's one way of establishing time management. Okay? This will help them manage their time effectively and transition smoothly between activities. Okay, so those are effective classroom management strategies. And of course, I also came across with this one, and I think it's very important to mention this one to you, that we have to involve our parents and communicate with them. Do you agree? Okay. Learning in school, learning English in school is both the responsibility of the school and home, of the teachers and the parents. So as teachers, you will become teachers later on, then you involve the parents, open the line of communication with them, right? Regular communication, maintain open and frequent communication with their parents through newsletters or emails and parent-teacher conferences. Okay, the feedbacking is important. Share updates on their child's progress and discuss any concerns or questions. The parents would really love to hear from their children's teacher. They would love to hear about what they can do to help their kids. They would love to hear from the teachers about how their kids perform in the classroom. Okay, next one is homeschool connections. Because when you involve parents in the improvement of their children, you encourage parents to support their children's language learning at home. So earlier when I said you have to provide them a rich language, so when you talk to the parents, because your son or your daughter is still not so good with the use of the English language, can you help us with this goal? Can you speak English at home? Can you talk to your son or your daughter in English so that he also or she also speaks English in school? You get my points? Okay, creating opportunities for them to practice English for reading, storytelling, and everyday conversations. Because again, in order for one to master English, relevant or meaningful practice should be present. Hear, hear. Okay. You cannot expect one to be fluent in English when there is no practice at home or in school. Okay, next one is parent workshops and events. Organize workshops and events to educate parents on effective strategies for supporting their child's language development at home. These can include tips for creating a language-rich environment and engaging in fun activities that promote language learning. Okay. Earlier, I shared a little story about teaching my kids how to learn English, right? So I thought of showing to you some of the clips that I did with my children, okay, with my daughters. So that's why they're able to speak the English language. They're able to learn how to speak the English language. Okay. So I hope you don't mind. Let me just share a video. Is it fine with you? Are you okay with that? Okay. Okay. This is just short for a while. Okay. Okay. By the way, Penelope now is already 9 years old. Okay. Okay, so I'll stop in there. Then let me continue my sharing with you. Okay, so why did I show that one? Just for me to share that parents also have responsibility in making their children read, in making them appreciate English. Do you understand, people? So it is really a shared responsibility. So if you are a teacher, you also do what you can do in order to make your children love English, appreciate English, speak English. For me, that is important, that they appreciate English, that they do not find it something that is a burden to them. Because there are children, now we just don't know, they find it like it's a burden for them. Okay, it's a burden for them to learn English. So you just expose them with activities. So you engage them. That's why you help them, of course, when they are learning the English language. Okay, let me go back to my presentation. Okay, so preparing young learners for success, teaching English to young learners is an incredibly rewarding experience. Now, as a primary teacher myself, as an elementary teacher, I am a licensed elementary teacher in English. It would be very much more than a rewarding experience if your learners learned English, if you fuel them that drive to learn English, okay? By providing a nurturing environment, engaging activities, and effective strategies, educators like you, you'll become teachers, can empower young children to develop a strong foundation in English, setting them on a path for future success. So this foundation will not only enhance their communication skills, but also open doors to new opportunities and wider world of possibilities. I urge you to be the best teachers that you can, to be the instruments of making our little children love English, because after all, English is the lingua franca of the world. All right, thank you very much. That ends my sharing with you. Now, if you have questions, let me just know.
Okay. For Prof. Crisanto Tay, thank you very much for giving such information and interesting presentation. And for ladies and gentlemen, now we come to question and answer session. I'd like to have any question from the participants. Please, I would like question from the participant. For those who would like to ask question, please click the raise hand or raise your hand icon. Please, thank you.
Yeah, Akma Januar Arifin has raised.
Mr. Arifin?
Ari.
Yes, thank you for the opportunity. Good morning, Prof. Daing.
Good morning, Ari. Go ahead.
I would like to ask Prof. Daing, during my time in the Philippines, I noticed that almost all elementary school children could speak English, which is very different from the situation in Indonesia. And even though English is taught from kindergarten in Indonesia, most students are not proficient or fluent in English. What I would like to ask is, what is the secret that makes this happen, where almost all elementary students in the Philippines can speak English? Can this method be applied in Indonesia? Thank you, Prof. Dai.
Okay, that's an interesting question. Thank you, Ari. Thank you, Ari, for that question. And I'm happy with your observation. And at least that is also one thing that you shared with your classmates when you went back to Indonesia. Perhaps you have this question in your head. Why is it that the elementary students in the Philippines could speak English? Then I would like to answer it. Number one, because of it's already part of our culture. Part of our culture in the sense that the second group of colonizers in the Philippines are the Americans. So during the time of the Americans, the Filipinos really were compelled on how to speak English. They were compelled on how they write English. Okay. So, and because of that, our curriculum, the second one is our curriculum is patterned after an American curriculum. Okay. And in our curriculum, English is part of the languages that have to be taught to children. Okay, the curriculum has already changed. Well, in fact, in our present curriculum, English is introduced when the students are in grade 3. When they are in first grade, second grade, they have to be taught in our local language, which is the Filipino. However, because the parents, the Filipinos, are very good speakers of the English language at home, when the children are growing, the parents are already teaching their children to speak the English language. I hope you understand my answer, Ari, that the teaching of English actually does not happen first in school. The teaching of English in the Philippines happens in our home when the children are growing. Because of the influence of the Americans, we also watch English movies. We read English stories. Okay? So that is basically because of our culture first, and because that is part of our curriculum second. Okay? And in fact, in the Philippines, we consider English as our second language. That is our second language. Compared to some other countries in Southeast Asia, that English is a foreign language. There's difference between the two. Do you understand? Perhaps in Indonesia, I also read the history of Indonesia. Parang you were colonized by European countries like Portugal. I hope my research was correct, no? Portugal by Dutch people. So the language was different, right? But in the Philippines, because it's part of our culture, that's part of our curriculum, English is our second language. Unlike in some other countries like Indonesia or Thailand, that English is a foreign language. Right? Thank you, Ari, for your question. Interesting.
Thank you, Prof. Taying.
Are you happy with my answer, Ari?
Yeah, I'm very happy.
Thank you.
Very happy with your answer.
Okay. Thank you for Mr. Ari for the question. Maybe for another participant for the question, please click your raise hand icon. Another question, please. dari teman-teman sekalian yang ingin bertanya, mengenai materi pada pagi hari ini, boleh raise hand. Silakan yang mau bertanya, saya persilahkan. Oke, from Miss Rizka Yulia, we welcome for your question.
Oke, okay, thank you. Hello, Mr. Before it, I want to ask about how to spell spelling your name. Yeah, it's Prof. J.
Yeah, it's Daing. It's Daing.
Oh, okay, 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 Prof. I want to ask. I want to ask about the how to make English learning to different intelligence of the student. As you know that the student have the different intelligence like kinesthetic intelligence, linguistic intelligence, and then interpersonal intelligence, and I want to asking for the different of intelligence of the student, how to make it English learning more I'm sorry, I forget the vocab in English. But this is my question, Professor. I wish you understand what I'm asking for.
Yeah, I think Sir Taufik can help me in translating or making that question a little bit better.
Okay. Wait a second, Professor. The question is how to make English learning to different intelligence of the student.
Right. Oh, very nice question. Okay. I understand. In our classroom, our students have individual differences. And we might have fast learner students, correct? Average learner students and slow learners or slow learners. So the different intelligences of our students. The best answer to that question, Rizka, that's a very interesting question. It is because we are really aware that in our classroom, our students vary in intelligences, correct? Okay, our students have different intelligences. Am I correct, people? Okay.
So, that's right. Yeah.
And it would be very difficult if we have a uniform activity or uniform as strategies for our students. Okay. So that's why, as teachers of English, our students have different intelligences, they have different capacities. Let us be creative in providing them activities that suit their intelligence level. I hope you got my points. Okay, so if you have slow learners, then you provide them activities that their capacity can help them learn English. Do not provide them activities that are advanced because they might not be able to understand it. When you have fast learner students, the intelligent students, and you give them activities that they no longer enjoy because they already learned it, and only the slow learners can learn it, our fast learners might be bored in our classroom. Do you get that? So you provide them activities, you cater to their level of intelligence. So that's why, if you're familiar with differentiated instruction, we can discuss the same lesson, but then let us give them choices, activities that they can perform according to their level of intelligence. And of course, you give more priorities and time to the slow learners so that they can be able to catch up with the lesson. Okay? No one should be left behind in our English classroom. So we scaffold learning of the slow learners and the average learners so that they can be, you know, they can learn with the fast learners, because our intention is to make them learn English. Okay? But if our strategy is the same, our activity is the same, then that is going to be a failure, because you do not provide activities according to their needs. Thank you, Rizka, Yulia, for your question. I hope I was able to satisfy you with my answer.
Okay, bro. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you for Ms. Rizka for the question. And the next question for Ms. Aktora. Raise your hand, please. Okay. Please welcome Ms. Aktora.
Hello, my name is Aktora Sonia. How to teach English in elementary school in Java where we have more than one official language? Thank you.
Suaranya kurang keras. Mic-nya mati, Mbak. Ms. Aktora, please repeat your question, please.
How to teach English in elementary school in Java where we have more than one regional language? Thank you.
Where there are more?
Ulang sekali lagi, Mbak.
How to teach English in elementary school in Java where we have more than one regional language?
More than one language.
Yeah.
Yeah, okay. So, of course, first, the children should be exposed to English language. I know it is really a challenge. It is really a challenge. But you start from the basic, okay? In fact, my way of teaching the kids on how to appreciate English is I teach them the sounds of the alphabet. So, of course, we're using the English alphabet, no? You just don't teach them about the letters because they might be confused about the letters. Okay, so you teach them about the sounds, because that's the basic thing. Because if they know the sound of the letter, then they will be able to blend the sounds when they create a word. For example, when you are teaching the sounds of the letters for the word cap, so you teach them the sounds of k and the a and t. So when they learn about the sounds and you present them cats, so they have to say at, at. So they form the word cats, right? Because you teach them the sounds. There is, according to Muhammad, in Indonesia, we master 1 to 2 local languages and 1 national language before we learned English. It's the same way with the Filipinos, Sir Taufik. So aside from our national language, I also have my local language. We have Bisaya and we have Cebuano before we learn Tagalog. So I think that has something to be combining all the support in the environments. And it would be a lot better when we start from the basics, okay? And infused with patience and consistency. consistency of the use of the English language. Because nothing will happen if you're teaching English in school and when the student goes back at home, English is no longer spoken. You get my point? Or worse, you are in an English classroom, but you are not using English in the discussion. Or the English teacher does not use English all the time. It is going to be a waste. You get my point? So there must be consistency. So there is a support from the school, from the teachers, from the environment, and support at home. These are the things that I discussed earlier in my presentation. Thank you. I hope I was able to answer your question.
Okay, Ms. Actora. Thank you for the question. And the last question from Ms. Hones Umi Kalsum. Ms. Hones.
Okay, yeah, okay. Okay, thank you for the time that is given to me. Maybe I just want to underscore the word consistency that is already said by Prof. Daeng. Okay, Prof, my question has also relation to Ari's question. Why we cannot have English skill fluently like Philippines has? Maybe is it true, the reason? I just want to add the reason, because whether is it true or not. Because in Indonesia, English is just English is a foreign language, but in Philippines, English is the second language. Is that correct? So that's why we Indonesian cannot speak or cannot have English skill well, because we just use it in a class. Maybe it's just only once a week, and we do not use English outside the class.
Right.
Okay, and. Yeah, betul. Okay, sorry. Okay, and in Philippines, all people use it every day, whether it is official or unofficial. So they can have English skill well, and it makes the difference between we as Indonesian as and Philippine. They can speak English well because they have it as an foreign and no, as it's like their second language, but it is different with us. We have it as English as a foreign language. Is that also true? What I mean is, is my reason correct according to your opinion? Okay, thank you.
Yes.
That's what I want to say.
Yeah, thank you so much, ma'am, honest, for your insights. That's really very true. Because I mentioned earlier about our curriculum, right? In our curriculum, English is not just one subject. The rest of our subjects are taught in English. And in fact, there is only one subject that is taught in our local language, in our national language. So all the subjects are taught in English. Okay? And it's true that everybody here speaks English, whether in school, at home, wherever you go. Though we speak our national language, but then when people ask us in English, foreigners talk to us in English, we communicate in English. So your reasons, Ma'am Honest Umi, really are very evident, not very true. So I think if you really want your children to speak English very well, because the world, the landscape, has also changed, no? The education landscape has also changed. Then you may suggest to your Indonesian government to look into your curriculum. Perhaps it's about time to add more minutes in teaching English in the classroom, right? Because consistency really is one thing. That's why people speak English very well. Thank you.
Yes, okay, Prof. Daeng, thank you for your response, your answers.
Thank you so much, Alditri. Are we okay, or are there still some questions?
Okay, maybe Mr. S for the last question for in this lecture today. So Thank you for your great answer, Prof. Cristanto Day. And thank you for the question from the participant. I'd like to thank so much to the speakers, Prof. Day, for information and interesting presentation, and to the participants for very active in this lecture today. Hopefully, the summit will be beneficial for everybody. I mean, come please give applause for the speaker and for you all. Applause, yay.
All right, thank you so much to our dear students and the College of Elementary Education in Universitas Muhammadiyah Surakarta. And thank you, Sir Taufik, for inviting me once again. It's always been my pleasure to be sharing with you my experiences as well as my expertise in elementary education. Thank you.